My name's Bishop Simon Githigi, serving with Elim Pentecostal Church, and this is my wife Beatrice.
Bishop Githigi and Mrs. Beatrice Githigi are the leaders of Elim Pentecostal Kenya and the directors of God Bless You Foundation.
God gave me this vision back in 1982, and God spoke clearly to me that He will give us this ministry to help the poor. In 1990, God spoke to us about Turkana, the north. And in 1992, we did our first trip to Turkana.
People in Turkana knew nothing about Jesus. When preached to, they actually asked when Jesus would physically visit their village.
We talked about Jesus. They were asking, when will He come to visit our village? 1994, we went back again to Turkana. We found a lady who had a son, 6 months old, and he was sucking the mother. And when I entered there, she looked unto me like 2-3 times. And she wanted to talk to me. The boy is still sucking, and the woman is looking unto me. She looked unto me, tried to open her mouth to speak. 3 times. The third time, she died. I went down, picked the boy, pressed him on my chest, and that time again, the Lord spoke to me about sharing our blood with the hungry.
They did not know how to establish the vision. Then they received a call.
We received a call from the Netherlands. And this call was of a man who was our friend. He was requesting me to go and minister to a soul survivor meeting. One lady in the meeting was touched because she had the same vision.
I heard Simon preaching in a soul survivor conference, and the story he told about a lady in Turkana who died, I thought maybe I could have an interview with him, a meeting with them, so that we can share experiences.
We managed to meet, we shared the vision together, and we connected so much, such that the same vision she had, what God had spoken to me is what God had spoken to her. And so we decided to start God Bless You Foundation.
They bought land in Kitale jointly and dedicated it to God. They then built a prayer center, an office, and prayer cubics.
In the year 2006, we finished building the prayer center, which is operational up to date. The doors of this building have never been closed since then.
I bless God for this place. I've been coming to this place for 3 years. This is the most consistent prayer center that I've been in for all my life.
It has also absorbed most of our youth who could have got lost, because most of them have been indulging in evil exercises. But now, this church has absorbed them. And also members of this community who were not going to other churches have come to join this church.
In the vision I had, I didn't feel like we need to create an orphanage, because I've visited many orphanages and I've seen street boys running away from orphanage back to street because of the way they've been dealt with, or they feel that like they've been locked in like a jail. So we thought of having a different kind of a structure of the orphans. That is when we decided to start the homes with a structure whereby we will have foster parents caring for the orphans.
I am 20 years old.
Stella Wanjiru is 20. Her mother passed on when she was little and her father died a year later. She was rejected by her aunties and uncles, so she moved in with her grandmother. She used to walk 5 kilometers to and from school, so her grandmother opted to take her to a children's home.
Life wasn't easy there, but it was much better than the life I had in the village, where I used to walk a long distance to school each day.
The children's home, they used to give us clothes.
Here, it was much better because they provided shoes, clothes, and also stationery. At the age of 6, I used to do my own laundry.
I used to wash my own clothes. I think the children's home became bankrupt or something. And they had to let us go. So they called our parents.
After a while, they ran bankrupt and had to let us go. They called our guardians, and since I had none, they called Bishop Simon, who came and took me to Kitale.
From the children's home to Kitale.
Our mother passed on.
Mwangi's mother died when he and his brother were 5 years and 2 years respectively. They moved in with their grandmother, who died 6 months later. The elder brother got a casual job but was underpaid. They didn't have enough food, so his younger brother became so weak to walk. Mwangi used to carry him on his back, hoping that their neighbor's children would share their food when they are full. Most of the time, it was impossible for their neighbor's children to have leftovers. His younger brother got wounded on the leg and didn't heal for a long time because of his immune system. Their grandmother's sisters came to visit and took him to hospital, and the wound was healed. She then took them to Nyaururu in a children's home.
Anthony was a very young kid, so he used to wet the bed. So now that was a very big problem to the guy because he never tolerated people who used to wet their bed. So alikuwa na mchapa sana.
He used to beat him up badly, and that affected him psychologically and left him with bad wounds on his back.
So all the body mgongo yake ilikuwa imejaa red.
It was hard for me also to watch my brother being beaten, and I couldn't do anything to stop it.
Anything to do, I had no power. Siko na uwezo ya kumzuia asimchape. I had just to keep quiet because also, if I had to talk, maybe tutafukuzwa huko. So, unavumilia tu yenye inakuja.
The bishop went to preach in Nyaururu, where an auntie went to speak to him about Mwangi and the younger brother, and they were adopted.
I have one girl, and it was Esther. Esther was...
She had a heart problem and she couldn't get treatment.
The heart, ya Esther ni kubwa sana.
My name is Esther Petit. I was really sick. I had a heart problem. Sometimes I just feel a heart, something is in my heart. My mother did not have anything to do with me. She told me she was giving me even alcohol to take it so that I can be healed.
But I thank God because of Sophie, my daughter, second born. But I had a mission.
My daughter had gone to Turkana with a mission group. They found her abandoned in the desert. They took her to the area's chief, who gave them permission to bring her home.
Wakapewa barua na chief. Wakamleta mpaka kwangu nyumbani.
I'm Nelson Mandela. I was once a member of the street family.
We used to sleep on verandas, and at times the police would come and hustle us up.
Ma police zingine walikuja usiku wanapiga viboko.
Sleeping was a problem, but I thank God he sent a mom who took me off the streets and gave me the name Nelson Mandela.
There is one day that I went to Kitale town, and I was just buying a bread and some milk, and then I was surprised to meet a boy, and he said, "Mom, I don't know why he called me mom, but he called mom. Can you give me a bread? And I was having just a loaf of bread. And then akasema kama hautanipatia si unipe kubore yani kubore 5 shillings.
Nilikuwa nimemwomba pesa lakini hakunipea pesa, alikuja ameniambia.
I had asked her for money, but she didn't give me money. Instead, she offered to take me home with her.
Ndio akanitupa akanipeleka kwa children's home yake.
So nikamwambia like a joke.
I asked him jokingly, "Would you come home with me?" And he said yes.
Oh, ndio. Akasema ndio.
I was born and raised in the streets. And life isn't easy there. Some people beat up the street children while it's not their decision to be born in the streets. There is a time I went to visit them with mom and I was so happy they remembered me.
My education life was not easy because
sometimes when you go to class, some students call you a street kid and people don't want to associate with you in any way.
It's okay. So how do it go? You always associate with what? I say, I want to go around, I go.
One of the things we wanted to see is to see those children being cared for, being released in the morning as, you know, children, having somebody to tell them goodbye, and in the evening they have somebody to hold them back home. And we discussed this with Mama, and we felt that is the right way to go. And that's how we started to take children.
In 2006, they began a small class. Humble beginnings. The school that began in one class that doubled as an office finally became a tremendously big school.
We started with 12 kids in ECD and 5 children in standard 1.
Most parents could not afford to pay fees and paid in small installments or bought firewood and beans.
We found that so many kids who would like to get education are within, you know, our reach, Laundia, but very poor. You know, they are clever but poor. And on the other hand is that some of them were affected during the 2007, 2008, you know, crashes. So they ran away from Mount Elgon and came down here.
Almost 90% of the students are sponsored, since most of them come from poor families.
We approached our friends in Netherlands, and through an organization called Woudegis, we got help to build this classes.
Although it is private, but children are not private. That is what we always tell the proprietors or the directors. The syllabus has to be followed, the required books have to be followed, and I'm happy Madam adhered to that when we gave that advice, and she had to look for trained teachers.
The teachers here are very close.
The teachers are close to us and are very friendly. They help us whenever we go to them.
My name is Joshua Mugendi. I help Educate a Child Fund in resource and funds mobilization.
Educate a Child Fund was formed in 2013 to help those from poor families, those who are orphans from churches and school and are unable to pay their school fees.
God, our Father in heaven.
Lord, you have made us in knowledge and the skills that come from the books of the earth. You have filled our hearts with the truth and the love. So we will sing blessed excellence. God bless you, how you shine. We are filled with the passion to be educated. We can read, we can write, we are educated. So we will sing blessed excellence. God bless you, how you shine.
You have been handling orphans and the rest destitute students from miserable backgrounds. Situations that parents have been approaching this office at times shedding tears. But I can report one incident whereby one student went home and came with a coke. He carried a coke from home, that this one, I'm going to pay the school fees. My God. Very specific, we wanted kids from very poor families, kids that cannot be able to raise their school fees, orphan children. Through a partnership with pastors, local pastors and churches, schools, primary schools, we were able to identify a number of students that really needed support, financial support, and they were very willing to go on with their education.
My name is Ina Leah Enamoro. I'm 16 years old. I came from Marsabit in a place called Olfort. I still have both parents, but they don't have work. In our area, we normally have local people, they don't have any work. So even I'm a family of nine, and all of them, they don't have any work.
Kwa majina ni Mark Lieso. Tribe yangu ni Tasanach.
Mark comes from the northern part of Kenya, near Ethiopia border. He has four brothers and three sisters, and they are all married.
I received a child who claimed that he didn't have the parent, mother, father, but he was staying with the guardian. When at one point I tried to send them home, for only just 1,000 shillings, the student said, "Sir, please, I am a carpenter. I can go home and make a locker and bring. Please let me not go home, but rather let you wait for August. I go, I make two lockers, I come and pay school fees."
Alexander is 19 years, and when he didn't have school fees, he promised to make two lockers over the holidays to pay for his school fees.
My name is Kandia Robinson from Mount Elgon.
Robinson comes from Mount Elgon. He used to live with his mother, who struggled a lot to earn a living. They used to dig people's gardens to get money to pay for fees. The foundation is helping people in education, shelter, and also health. At this point, a health center was established.
This foundation has, it's fivefold. The vision that we have is fivefold. One is education. Two is shelter. And then we also thought, how can you have a home and not care about, the health of the people? That is where the vision of the health center came from.
After establishing the prayer center and the schools, that time when we were building, we experienced a lot of challenges. We could see ladies pregnant being taken to hospital, and some of them are coming from places that are impossible.
Many who have been falling sick have not been having a place to go for treatment, because the area for treatment is Moise Bridge.
Been doing well, and surely I can say this dispensary has been of great help, because it has been serving this community and also serving the school students as a school dispensary.
We've had lots of cases, you know, women coming here and sick people coming around. And it has also been a challenge for the upkeeping of this or the maintenance of this thing, because we do not charge, except that we have a very minimal cost, which we call cost sharing.
I thank God for my parents and the heart they have to serve. They have such big and huge hearts. I've learned to love.
Isaiah chapter 58 and verse 7 talks about sharing, you know, your bread with the hungry. So we thought it's good to feed, you know, even the poor. So we based this organization on the James chapter 1 and verse 27, which talks about the true gospel, the true religion, which is caring for the orphans and the widows. And that is how we started what we have today, what we are celebrating today, and what we see going on.